Joining me today at the Nest Summit is Ivka Kalous from Primeathos. Ivka, thank you so much for joining us at the Nest Summit.
Oh, thank you so much, Jeff, for letting me participate.
So, Ivka, in the work that you do as an asset manager, I think we've seen that COVID has really driven the demand for ESG, certainly on the social side. But as well, we're starting to see signs that on the climate side as well, there's more and deeper interest. Certainly fires in California, Australia, record heat temperatures. Do you think this is a fad being driven post-pandemic on these issues and concerns by customers and investors? Or do you think this is a sustainable trend that we're seeing right now?
I think it's really a super trend in terms of, you know, what COVID did is that it exposed massive cracks and gaps in our social, economic, and policy frameworks that define our daily lives and has made us realize how vulnerable we all are, which puts the focus on climate change and social justice as the greatest challenges of our time. I think a lot of people, investors included, are frustrated by their lack of agency when they see the callous and cruel assault on human dignity that COVID and now the Black Lives Matter movement have highlighted. And so the power of the purse seems to fill some of the agency void, both in terms of how people spend and how they invest. And I think it's permanent. I think COVID is going to leave a permanent mark on all of us. And we have to look forward. And ESG investing in climate change and social justice is all about managing future and externality risks. So it fits really well with the desire to create a future that is brighter than the present. And so I think it's here to stay and the genie is out of the bottle.
So post George Floyd, or at least pre-George Floyd, we were seeing a big pickup on climate related issues. And obviously post George Floyd and the death of George Floyd, we are seeing an incredible demand from people across the, not just United States, but Europe as well, for social justice to become part of the conversation in the capital markets. Do you think these are two competing trends that we're dealing with and one is sacrificed for the other, or do you think both can be complementary to each other?
Definitely the latter. I don't think you can have climate justice without social justice and vice versa. And what we do know is that climate change has a very significant social justice element in terms of impacting disenfranchised minority, poor communities disproportionately. And so, you know, that's from the moral side of the issue. But climate change is an all hands on deck kind of crisis. And there is so much lost innovation when social justice is denied. And you know, there's actually work done on this. There's a professor named Lisa Cook out of Michigan State who's actually quantified the amount, the economic impact of the lost innovation of racism in the U.S. And she estimates it to be about 3% per annum. And that's in economic terms. But if you think about it, we need all of that innovation and participation to manage the crisis. So there's a direct link, and you definitely don't need to just choose your topic of focus because they're interconnected and both equally important.
I appreciate those thoughts. Also, I just want to ask you, when we think about what the pandemic has illustrated for our least advantaged communities across not just America, but of course the globe, what does that illustrate on the effects that climate change is gonna actually have on disparate communities?
In terms of the pandemic, I mean, you have the same communities who have been impacted by COVID, communities, disadvantaged communities, minority communities, immigrant communities. And so if you think about climate change and the ability to adapt to climate change, it requires some amount of being connected, being enfranchised some amount of wealth. And so it's the same, I don't want to say target audience, but it's the same communities that will be impacted negatively by climate change as by COVID. And so COVID is, it's basically our trial run for how to deal with climate change. And so hopefully there'll be, you know, good lessons coming out of this in terms of how to resolve the crisis.
In regards to what we're seeing in the papers today, we're seeing this resurgence all of a sudden of ESG skepticism, different studies that are coming out challenging the worth of ESG as an alpha driver or a performance driver, and really saying that it's because of growth tilts or lack of exposure to oil. When you look at that skepticism that's rearing its head these days, what are your thoughts about it as a portfolio manager who's deeply invested in ESG as part of your process?
Yes, I think, I mean, it's always healthy to be skeptical of any trend in investing. Since once everyone jumps on board, then the opportunity gets arbitraged out. And that's certainly the case with ESG. If everyone starts to value and consider the externality risks that are generated by corporations, then ESG just turns into normal investing. And ESG investors will just be called investors. But I think that we're still a long ways from that, and there's still a lot of opportunity. But if you look at the current skepticism, there were a number of Financial Times articles and other articles elsewhere that pointed out that most of the outperformance during COVID came from funds being overweight to technology and to growth. Now, never mind that there's an issue with pointing to performance over any 3 or 6 month period as being statistically significant, but that doesn't show that ESG didn't matter. It only shows that those managers made an allocation decision or a style decision that added value. There's been a lot of other work done on ESG as standalone, non-correlated factors, and a lot of that work, you know, there's more and more metrics to look at that quantitative analysis can analyze to look whether it's statistically significant or not. And a lot of the work shows that ESG factors are statistically significant, non-correlated investment factors that add alpha. So again, I think skepticism is healthy, and if you get if you gain performance over a short period of time by being overweight the right style and right sector, more power to you. But that does not show that ESG doesn't add value, and the analysis over the longer term shows that it does.
And I mean, I've always thought about ESG as a risk mitigator as well, and not necessarily always looking at it as an alpha driver. Can you speak a little bit to that?
I'm sure. And in a way, I think we're talking about two sides of the same coin, because risk is return. And maybe you're thinking about mitigating downside risk. And certainly in terms of the factors that we look at, that we put under the ESG moniker, are corporate behaviors that tend to work over longer periods of time. Because companies that have, say, better diversity, that are constantly working to reduce their carbon footprint, that pay attention to the impact of their waste stream, you know, all of those things come back to those companies in terms of not having significant downside events. And so in that sense, there is that risk mitigation side of it, if we think about risk as being a significant drawdown.
And lastly, you've written a lot about how you cannot have the E and the G without the S. Can you elaborate a little bit on that for us?
You know, I don't want to take a Mitt Romney of context, but corporations are people. And it's true that, you know, the environmental and governance externalities that emanate from corporations are created by decisions. And so the S part of the analysis, whether it's the diversity of the management team that can consider, you know, can take a 360 view of how they're managing the business, or again, the employees and how they're treated, or the impact on the community. All of those factors then lead into how those corporations, how they decide on their governance structures and what impact they have on the environment, how they strive to adapt and mitigate climate change. And so it's sort of the Adam and Eve of ESG factors actually starts with the S.
And are you starting to see more companies being willing to disclose on data because of the pressure coming from COVID and George Floyd? Is this driving companies to be more transparent today?
I think it's coming. I'm not sure yet whether there's any consistency in reporting on things like diversity and impact. So far has mostly come from consumers, right, who have decided to use the power of the purse to make purchasing decisions based on how companies are reacting to, you know, the current social justice or lack thereof situation that we find ourselves in. And so investors are, you know, they follow on once we start having more and more reporting that comes as a result of the pressure of consumers right now.
Ivka, I want to thank you so much for joining us at the Nest Summit today. Ivka is the portfolio manager of Prometheus, an international manager specializing in ESG and climate risk. Thank you so much for being at the Nest Summit.
Thank you so much, Jeff. I really enjoyed it.